Starting this week, for the next 8 weeks, we'll be covering about the Christ of Christmas. And as a start, we'll be looking at Jesus as the suffering servant of God. Jesus, the suffering servant. Jesus, the suffering servant. This is how we're going to start for this series. Now, as a start, I want you to use your imagination this morning to go back 2,000 years ago. It is evening time, and it's middle of spring. And here are two men, disciples of Jesus, making the journey from Jerusalem to their hometown called Emmaus. And as these two men begin to walk down the windy road back to their hometown, as the evening sun begins to set, I'd like you to imagine yourself joining me on the same road as a fellow traveler with these two disciples. And we are just walking along, and I want you to use your imagination now to follow what is going on. As we walk along, here was a stranger that has walked a bit faster and then catching up with us. And we hear this stranger on this road asking the two disciples, "What's going on?" And here are these two disciples explaining to Jesus on this Sunday evening as to what has been happening in the last 3 days and how disappointed they were. And here was this stranger listening. And as they listen, as they walk along, then when the two disciples have got nothing more to say, it was almost toward the end of the journey, then this stranger began to talk and begin to share his perspective of what's happening. And this stranger began to say about the Old Testament, quoting from the prophets, starting from Moses and then to prophet Isaiah. And then he began to explain things that are happening right there in the Old Testament, explaining what has happened. Talking about the Messiah, the Christ, and about what had been recorded in the ancient past, hundreds of years before Jesus came, and what would happen to the Messiah, and why he would be suffering. And then the journey ended. They ended up in the home of one of the disciples, and they had a good meal, and then this stranger began to give thanks for the food, as he usually does. And suddenly, these two disciples' eyes were open. And then Jesus disappeared into thin air. Then these two talk among themselves. One said to the other, "Didn't our hearts get warm up, encouraged, inspired, when Jesus shared with us the work of the prophets, the words of the prophets, starting about his suffering?" Talking about his suffering. When this, our Lord Jesus, spoke to us about his sufferings from the records of the Old Testament prophets, didn't our hearts warm within us? We, as you begin to hear this, as you watch with me and listening to what was going on, what is the important thing that rose up in the sharing of Jesus. It was about his suffering. It talked about his suffering. Why did it and warm up the hearts of the disciples? Because he gave meaning to the sufferings. That's why today we want to begin talking about the suffering servant, Jesus. If you want to understand what's happening, you need to begin with the suffering of Jesus. But people don't like to hear about suffering. I remember one day I was on the running on the treadmill at a hotel. And as I was running, it happened that there was a big television screen in front of these treadmills that on that day was showing the floods in India, and the people were suffering and they were dying, and it was all bad news. Then there was another runner on the treadmill next to me, an American young man, suddenly turned to me and asked me, he said, "Mister, can you turn off the TV?" I asked him, "Why?" He said, "Look here, I come here to enjoy myself. I'm more interested in being, I'm trying to be a happy man. Look at this news, all this suffering. Look, I didn't come here to hear more about suffering. I don't like to hear about suffering. I like to hear about good times, happiness, fun." And of course, to please him, I turn off the television. What I'm trying to say is that people don't like to hear about suffering. Suffering is far from our minds. In fact, our today's society, everything that's advertised is about how to have a good time. Yes, it's important to have a good time. But the philosopher Ecclesiastes, King Solomon, wrote this in Ecclesiastes 7:14. He said, "When times are good, be happy. But what about when times are bad? Consider." Consider what? Consider that God has made them both. But Ecclesiastes, the philosopher, says that it is even more important to learn about sufferings than about happy times. Because in happy times, although you enjoy yourself, you learn nothing. But in bad times, when you suffer, that's the time when we learn a lot of things. Particularly if the suffering is meaningful. And if God made them both, they must be meaningful. So today, I want to take you through the prophet Isaiah that Jesus must have been quoting from. The prophet Isaiah chapter 52. Now, I've given you the notes, the passage are there, and I'm going to use a version called the Message. The Message version of the translation, because it has got meanings here which are a little bit more explicit in the modern language. So I'm going to read from the Message version of the book of Isaiah, and I'm going to start from chapter 52 and verse 11. And I'm going to read to you what the prophet Isaiah says. All right? So you turn to your Bibles. It doesn't matter what version you have, but you just follow me. I'll be reading from a more modern version. So in Isaiah 52, verse 11 onwards, it says here that it was our pains that Jesus carried. It is the writing of prophet Isaiah 700 years before Jesus arrived. It says, "Just watch my servant blossom, exalted, tall, head and shoulders above the crowd." But he didn't begin that way. At first, everyone was appalled. He didn't even look human, talking about Jesus. And the first thing, he didn't look human, was a ruined face, disfigured past recognition. This is the key phrase I want you to remember. Ruined face. We are talking about face. The face of Jesus was ruined. It was marred, if you are using the King James Version. It was marred. Disfigured past recognition. Can you see the word? His face marred beyond recognition. That's a key phrase I want you to remember today regarding the suffering of Jesus. There are many things I'm going to talk about, but I'd like you to remember this particular phrase, that the suffering of Jesus is considered from his face, a ruined face, marred face, disfigured beyond recognition. Nations all over the world be in awe, taken aback. Kings shocked into silence when they see him. For what was unheard of, they will see with their own eyes. What is unthinkable, they will have right before them. And then today's passage, Isaiah 53, talking about Jesus. Who believes what we have heard and seen? Who would have thought God's saving power would look like this? The servant grew up before God, a scrawny seedling, a scrubby plant in a parched field. Verse 3, there is nothing attractive about him, Jesus. Nothing to cause us to take a second look. You take a second look when it's something attractive. But this is not how it looked like. He was looked down on and passed over, a man who suffered, who knew pain firsthand. The man Jesus knew pain firsthand. One look at him and people turn away. We look down on him, though, as though thought he was scum. Verse 4. But the fact is, it was our pains he carried, our disfigurements, all the things wrong with us. We thought he brought it on himself, that God was punishing him for his own failures. Verse 5. But it was our sins that did that to him, that ripped and tore and crushed him, our sins. He took the punishment, and that made us whole. Though his bruises, through his bruises, we get healed. We are all like sheep who wandered off and gotten lost. We have done our own thing, got our own way, and God has piled all our sins, everything we have done, on him. We stop here. Take note of the last phrase. God has piled all our sins, everything we have done, upon him. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come before you and ask that your spirit will reveal to us so that we may know a little bit more, to know better about Jesus, our Redeemer. Open our eyes that we might see wondrous things out of your word, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, this current series we are talking about is about appreciating Jesus. You'll need to switch your radio frequency, as it were, from what we've been talking about in the past months about covenant, about how to be successful by seeking the face of God, about how to be wholehearted in loving God. Last week we talked about caring for the people of God. And then we have talked about Ezra, who had the hand of God upon him and how he mastered the word of God, and that made a difference. But the next 8 weeks, I need you to change gears from learning about how to be successful to knowing about a person. We've been talking about how to serve God, but now in the next 8 weeks, we have to look at how to see God, how to see Jesus, how to understand. And this is the first thing that Paul prays for the Ephesian Christians. He prayed that they may know about Jesus, know about the riches of his inheritance. He prayed for them that they may have the spirit of wisdom and revelation to know him better. It's about knowing. It's about seeing. When Paul wrote to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians, talking about the devil covering the eye, blinding the eyes of those who know not God, and he prayed this, that we may see the glory of Jesus. So this coming weeks, you have to switch gear from serving to seeing the Son of God. Not so much about what you're going to do for Jesus, but more about seeing the value of Jesus. How wonderful he is. You see, all of us who are Christians, we know every time we come to break bread, we remember the sacrifice of Jesus. We talk about the cross. But many of us just know the word sacrifice. What does that really mean? Now, you can't really understand what it really means until you know what exactly is this sacrifice about. So the prophet Isaiah now brings us to this part, which is about seeing Jesus suffering. And for you to grasp a little more detail, to enter into the more, a bit deeper, into understanding of the suffering and the sacrifice that Jesus made for you and me, then we have to go back to this famous passage the prophet Isaiah spoke about. And the key word here I'd like you to remember is we can begin to look at his face. From the notes I've given you, we talk about Jesus' sacrifice involved enduring excruciating pain. What did Jesus really endure? So, even the writer to Hebrews, Paul, was talking about all the heroes of faith in chapter 11, and then suddenly in chapter 12, Paul switches to say, now, I want to talk about something else. That you will be looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. It's about endurance. So how do we look at this endurance? Let's begin with his face. Because it says his face was marred beyond recognition. Look at the face of a person. What is the first thing that you recognize a person? It is about his face. And is he a handsome man? Or a beautiful face of a beautiful woman? It attracts our attention. If this guy has got an ugly face and he's like a guy who has just come from a boxing match, his face has been punched blue and black, his eyes are swollen, his face is out of shape, and he looks miserable, who wants to look at this kind of a face? And that's exactly what the scripture says. He didn't begin this way. Yes, he was tall. There's great beauty in him, but when it comes to the sacrifice, he didn't begin this way. He, in fact, when we look at him, we are appalled. You know, every picture that artists have drawn about Jesus is always a handsome man and with flowing locks and full of dignity. But here, he didn't even look human. His face was out of shape. And we don't want to look at this kind of a face. When he was sacrificed, he had an ugly face. You're so bad, we don't even want to look at it. It's appalling, the version, some version says. But we get turned off. We don't like to look at this kind of a face because his face was marred. In fact, the word appalling means he was shocking. He was repulsive. We look at it, we don't like to look. In fact, a better word, we were so grotesque that we don't like to look his face. So this is how his face looked like. And why is his face so ugly? What happened, firstly, to his face? Well, if you follow the gospel narratives about the last days of Jesus, you will see that his face has been manhandled left, right, and center. The first time he was being arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane, they tied his hands. And when the relative of the high priest questioned him, he tried to answer. And the servant of the priest slapped his face violently with their callous hands. This was only the beginning. His face became a punching bag for the next 10 hours. Because not only was he slapped by the priest and punched, again when he was being, after he was being sentenced, the soldiers that took him to the side of the barracks, they also whack his face with a stick, with a staff, with a thick stick, and they whack him on the head, and they beat him until it swelled. Then they put a crown of thorn on his head. They abuse him to inflict maximum pain so that they can enjoy the response of Jesus. Just looking at people suffering, how cruel can it be? And then the prophet Isaiah described in chapter 50. Because this description comes in four songs about the suffering Savior. And then in chapter 50, the suffering began. And it tells us about him who was being abused. And the prophet Isaiah, speaking first in the person of Jesus, said, "And I gave my beard to them that pull my beard and pull out my beard." That is so insulting. So along the places where the beard was being pulled out, there'll be bleeding. It is messy. Then what else happened? When they whack him with a staff and make fun of him and mocked him, you get swollen. The crown of thorns get beaten in and the thorns dig deeper. And then they spat into his face. It's a spitting of contempt by their soldiers. So what do you expect from such a face that has been mistreated by punching, slapping, beating, thorns being placed, beard being pulled out? Not only was it out of shape, swollen, not only was the color different, it's a blue and black instead of the pink of health, flowing with the spit from the mouth of the soldiers flowing down his face. Man, it not only looked bad, it smelled bad. And with blood dripping, that is really a gory picture. We don't like to look at this kind of face. But you know something about the face? He lost face. Meaning he had to face humiliation. He lost face. In the Mandarin, we say, to lose a face means what? To lose your dignity. Jesus experienced all this firsthand. So sometimes we feel the same, isn't it? But here we are talking not about ourselves. It's about Jesus. He had to face this so that we don't have to lose face. He endured this because the shame was transferred to him. That's what it says here. There's nothing attractive about himself. Nothing to cause us to take a second look. One look at him and people turn away. We look down on him. We don't understand that the loss of face, he was taking the full weight of our shame. He was marred. His face was marred. Because that is a representation of all of us. Sin marred our face in the sight of God. And now, the first place of attack and endurance was the face, and Jesus took it all so that when one day when we stand before God, we don't have to lose face. We can have dignity because our disgrace has been transferred to Jesus and his dignity is transferred to us in that divine exchange. So he was punched, he was mocked, he was insulted in his face. So when you look at the face of Jesus on that day, it is a ruined face. It was disfigured past recognition. Yet he lost face because of us. Because our sins were placed on him. It says, who would have thought God's saving power would look like this? That's why Jesus' face is so repulsive, so ugly, because he's bearing our ugliness. Sin makes our face ugly in the sight of God. There's something you need to know, how men perceive how we look and how God perceives how we look. We have a face that's out of shape because we lie. Sometimes we are shameless. But God transferred that ugliness of sin on the face of Jesus. That's the first thing he endured. Secondly, he endured suffering on his body. It says here that he was, by his stripes, we are healed. He was wounded. Verse 5, it was our sins that did that to him, that ripped and tore and crushed him. Our sins were the one that crushed him, it says. He took the punishment that made us whole through his bruises on his body. We get healed. Healed from what? Well, first of all, it depends on which part are you talking about. First of all, I like this word that his back become our cover. Earlier on in this song, it tells that the words of Jesus, I gave my back to them that beat me or lacerate me. So his back was hit at least 40 times by the whip, and his back was lacerated. Now, it's interesting that the Chinese word for cover is this. It's a picture of a lamb on the altar. So when Jesus was being sacrificed on the cross, or before that he was being beaten with many stripes, lacerated body, what was he doing? In the spiritual realm, this is what I'd like you to use your imagination. That actually, we were being beaten. We had to be punished for our sin. But Jesus come along and cover us so that he gets the punishment. That's exactly what the scripture says. That God was punishing him for our failures. Every sin needs to be punished. This is the law of God because of holiness. But Jesus gave his back as the cover for our punishment. He was punished. Verse 5. He took the punishment that made us whole. And through his bruises, we get healed. Healed from what? Healed from our pain. Because Jesus suffered the pain firsthand. We all have some kind of pain in one way or the other. We all suffer the pain of rejection. And sometimes we feel so small. We need to be covered. And Jesus' body became the covering for our sin. That's the kind of thing he had to endure. Then his body was wounded for our transgressions. And the word here is he was pierced. He was pierced in a number of places. His hand, his feet, and his side. The piercing of his body has to do with paying the penalty for our transgressions. That means we have broken God's holy laws. We have lied, we have cheated, we have committed adultery, whether it be physically or mentally. We have not honored God as we are supposed to do. And therefore, we sin against God with our hands, with our feet. Every part of us that sin against God, that work evil works, penalty have to be paid, and Jesus paid in full. So he was pierced for our transgressions. But there's one thing that he was also pierced on his side, and water and blood flowed out. And theologians tell us this is a sign that he died of a broken heart. Even before he was pierced, he died of a broken heart. And many of us, we have faced brokenness in our lives. We feel our hearts are broken when people are disappointing us. People who are supposed to take care of us do not do so. They betray us. There is rejection, they despise us, and many of us, sometime or other, face brokenness in our hearts. And he died of a broken heart because the Father had rejected him. Because this was necessary, because he was bearing our sin. He was a sin bearer. And therefore, this payment for our sins, our transgressions, for breaking God's laws, are fully paid for. He died of a broken heart so that we can repair our broken heart. Bring your broken heart to the Lord Jesus. Your disappointment, your disillusionment, the betrayals that hurt you. Everybody has faced this in one way or the other. That's why we need to be healed. And we are being healed by his pierced side. And he died of brokenness in our place. So that goes for his body, that goes for his back, and what else Jesus endured? The second thing we talk about now is he endured extreme emotional pain. We know that mental stress, emotional stress, is even harder to heal than physical injuries. Yes, Jesus endured physical pain, and behind it, every one of those physical injuries, there is a spiritual debt that he was paying for us. But now we are talking about his emotional pain, which is far harder. Firstly, it was humiliation in the hearts of people who are his created beings, his creatures. Humiliation come because of loss of face, loss of face because of loss of respect. In fact, it was so humiliating that Jesus had to set his face like a flint, says Prophet Isaiah. Setting your face like a flint means he had to endure, he had to strengthen his resolve to carry on because he was rejected of men. And then rejected by the Father because of being a sin bearer. One of the things that he had to endure is rejection from birth to death. There's no end to his rejection. He was rejected at birth when he went to the inn. There was no place in the inn. Why was there no place in the inn? Well, if you pay enough, high enough, you bribe, you might get a place in the inn. But obviously, the innkeeper didn't think that his parents got any money. Therefore, the best thing he could do is, well, there is a stable, you know, pass the night there. Here's a pregnant woman about to give birth. The innkeeper didn't see that he was worthy of making a room for him, for them, for him. As a toddler, King Herod rejected him when he heard that he was born the king of the Jews. He had to flee. As a toddler, his parents had to take him. All the way, the moment he started, the first day, he announced through reading the scriptures that the Lord God has anointed him to preach the good news, to heal the brokenhearted, to set the captives free, and so on. And when he said, this scripture today is fulfilled in your presence, they wanted to kill him. There was no end to the persecution he suffered. The Jews were always after him. The religious leaders, the lawmakers called the Sanhedrin was after him. In fact, they had plotted all the way to kill him. And their plot seemed to succeed in the last day. Seemed to succeed because God allowed it. God made use of evil men to orchestrate his plan. Make no mistake about it. God was behind the pain of Jesus. Therefore, he was a man of sorrows. He was well acquainted with grief. Whose grief? Our grief. Because when Jesus died on the cross, the sorrow of suffering was upon him. In fact, it all began on the night before he was crucified. He was in the Garden of Gethsemane. You know what Gethsemane means? It means oil press. In that garden, Jesus was pressed beyond measure. And he said, I'm exceedingly sorrowful and have great heaviness as he saw the impending sacrifice coming. It was not the physical pain alone. It was the spiritual sacrifice that God, his Father, is going to strike him. The prophet Isaiah says, he's smitten of God. It was God's master plan. It was also Jesus' master plan. So, right there, he was going through sorrow. Then, when he hung on the cross, it says here in the Word of God, he was smitten of God. God was the one who punished him. Now, it is not fate that punished him. Some people thought that, well, he was a victim of his circumstances. He was being arrested. Everything was orchestrated against him. He was a victim. No, he wasn't a victim. He was a victor. And he was there, although God forsaken. He says here in the scripture that he did not open his mouth. He was silent. So the scripture says here that as a sheep taken to the slaughter, he remained silent. Why? Because he was found guilty on our behalf. He took all our sorrows upon his body, all our grief, all our sin. Therefore, he became the guilty party. And he was submitted to this. That's why he didn't open his mouth to defend himself. He took it silently. No complaints. In other words, he took it willingly on our behalf. He took it because he was submitted to the Father's will, but he also took it silently because he was making payment on our behalf. And why was he willing to do so? Because of the joy that was set before him. Because of the purpose. We are going to talk about that shortly. And on the 3A, I give you some points that he, for whom did he suffer? For Paul, he is very simple. He said, the Son of God loved me and gave himself for me on the cross. He loved me and gave himself for me. Can you see that the cross was not prepared for Jesus? It was prepared for you and me. It was also prepared for a guy called Barabbas, the criminal that deserved to be crucified. And he took Barabbas' place. Barabbas is a representation of you and me. We deserve to be hanging on a cross, but Jesus took our place. And Paul says, because the Son of God loved me. And 2 Corinthians, Paul says again that for our sakes he became poor. For our sakes he endured the suffering. And, you know, it was because he sees high value in our lives that the Bible says it pleased God. Was it because God was pleased to inflict pain? No. It pleased God that the Son was willing to go all the way and make payment for our sins so that we all can be the redeemed ones. For up to this point, no one could enter into God's presence. No one could come into heaven. We're all sinners. But the suffering is necessary. Lastly, I want to talk about the purpose a bit more. Why was the Father pleased? And why was it that it's the Father who smite him and struck him and killed him, even as he hung on the cross? Why was it that the Father was getting him to make the payment for sin to such an grotesque extent? Well, firstly, because it was necessary for our redemption. And God puts high value in our souls and our spirit and our lives to win us. And in order to do so, Jesus had to be our substitute. He had to take our place on the cross. The cross is the designed for you and me, but Jesus took our place. So we call it substitute. And he paid the full penalty for sin for all our sins without exception. Once and for all. In other words, his sacrifice is so powerful that it takes care of all our sins for all times, for all people, and paid in full. That's why he substitute for us. That's the first thing. If Jesus did not substitute at all, you and I have got no way out but to pay the penalty for sin ourselves. That will mean death. That will mean hell. That will mean eternal punishment. When he hung on the cross, why was his face marked more than any man? Because he was imputing his righteousness on us. Now this, you need to understand, that no one can ever come before God without righteousness. Only the absolutely righteous person can enter into the presence of God. And we are not righteous. We are sinful people. But Jesus, the righteous one who had no sin, when he made the sacrifice, in so doing, he not only substitutes for us, he imputes, transfers the righteousness that he had on us. And he took upon himself our unrighteousness. So that is carried by the word justified. By his work, by his death, he will justify many. He justifies us, meaning to say, now I'm righteous before God. If he only substitutes for us and the righteousness is not imputed, we still have no right to stand before God and enter into heaven. So this is very important. He transfers his righteousness to us. Thirdly, he removes our guilt. As far as the east is from the west, the scripture says it, the psalmist says, so far has he taken our sin from us. You know, when something goes east and something goes west, well, they never meet. So far has he taken our sins from us. And because his face was marked more than any man, he restores our dignity. He gives us back our sense of worth, because we were worthless, spoiled by sin. He transfers the dignity to us, making us a member of God's family. This is restoring our relationship with God and removing all our shame. Sometimes When we look back, each of us, we must surely have got times when we did things we feel shameful about. We don't want to talk about it. In fact, we don't want to even remember it. But you know, God has taken that shame away. So this day, you don't have to feel shameful, because your shame has been transferred to Jesus. He took the full weight of shamefulness. Therefore, you can walk with our heads lifted high, because we are set free from the weight of our past shame. Remember this. He took care of our shame, our guilt. So sometimes you feel, remember some bad things you have done in the past, you really feel terrible, you feel guilty, sense of guilt coming back. Just remember, it is settled on the cross. By grace has He done so. Then, so what does Jesus get out of this? Well, firstly, He sets a high value on our lives. He wants us. He wants us to be with Him for eternity. Secondly, God was fully satisfied with His face being marred beyond any man. Fully satisfied means that the mission was fully accomplished. What is the mission? The redemption plan that was made in eternity past, before the world was created, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit got together and made this redemption plan that Jesus would come. And God gives so many of these pictures in the Old Testament. You all know the story of Abraham, how he brought his own son Isaac. And he was supposed to kill Isaac as a sacrifice with his own hands. It's bad enough sacrificing his own son, but he's called upon to kill his own son with his own hands. But God had a substitute, right? You know that story. There was a ram in the thicket that substitute for his son. Just remember, God didn't have a substitute for his son. And he had to strike the blow. So in the physical realm, they struck the blow physically, but in the spiritual realm, God struck the blow that killed his son. And it so happened, it satisfied all the requirements for us to be purchased from slavery to freedom, from hopelessness, from a hopeless end to an endless hope. This is the biggest transaction in the history of the world. Transaction carried out by Jesus Himself. And you and I have the privilege to be the recipients of this transaction. That's why in the letter of the Hebrews, we are reminded that Jesus, for the joy that was set before Him, joy over our redemption set before Him, He endured the cross and despised the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Therefore, consider Him. What do you look at? What else do we see? Consider that He endured such contradiction of sinners against Himself, lest you be weary and faint in your minds. So He went all the way because He sees great value in you and I. Sometimes we don't even think we are worth much. But God thinks we are worth much, so much that He sacrificed His own Son. And therefore, this is the redemption plan that was fulfilled. Mission accomplished. So the Father rejoiced. So that's the end of this psalm, of this song. So we read in verse 10. I like to read to you the modern translation. Still, it is God. It is what God had in mind all along It is what God had in mind all along to crush him, Jesus, with pain. The plan was that he give himself as an offering for sin, so that he would see life come from it. The abundant life that Jesus promised to give us. And God's plan was would deeply prosper through him. So God's plan was deeply prospered. It succeeded. So today we are the recipients of that great success. It was a big plan, a master plan, redemption plan, the Father had planned. So today, what are we supposed to do? I like that song that I remembered learning in the early days of my Christian life. It's a song that says, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Today's message about turning our eyes upon Jesus. Today's message is not what you have to go out and do. Today's message is not about what you need to do. Today is just turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. Even though it was a face that's marred more than any man. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. It's all about grace. You know, we hear about grace, we use the word grace, we sing about grace, amazing grace. What does that grace look like? Today's message, the suffering. He's made his face marked more than any man, beyond recognition. This is a face of grace. Look full in his wonderful face, so that you and I will have a wonderful face when we stand before God. We have a face that God will recognize because he loved us and gave himself for us. That's what it all means. So as you meditate on this today, I'd like you to just move away from thinking, what must I do? No, it's not about what you must do. We're looking at what Jesus has done. And to rejoice that we are the recipients of God's love. So every time you ever ask, does God love you? Jesus said, greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend. What do you mean by lay down his life? Endured suffering. Actually, Jesus not only died for our sin, because some people find that death is not so terrible. It's suffering that's terrible. That's why in the early days of the Spanish explorers that came to Brazil, they prayed to a god, a spirit called San Morte. Why did they worship this devilish god? It's called the spirit of death. San Morte is the spirit of death because they just want to die a peaceful death. They are afraid of the pain. Some of us are very afraid of the pain. But I want you to know that nobody suffered such excruciating pain that Jesus suffered. In fact, the word excruciating comes from the pain that is found from the cross. But more than just the cross, the separation, the shame, his face marked more than any man. Today, as you come into the presence of God, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Today, get to know him better. Today, when we talk about sacrifice, now you know better. What do you mean by sacrifice? It's about being a carrier of sin and a carrier of sorrow and a carrier of pain, which was done firsthand. So never say, Lord Jesus, you don't understand my problem. You don't understand my pain. It's we who don't understand his pain. He has borne our pain so that we might be set free from the fear of suffering, the fear of bad news. That courage comes from Jesus. He wants to impute that to us. He wants to transfer that to us. Will you just receive that courage that you will not fear suffering? In fact, Jesus suffered for us, leaving us an example. He didn't suffer for himself. He suffered for us, leaving us an example. An example for what? That we might be able to follow his steps. That we will not fear any suffering. We will not fear death. He has shown us how. And he has given us the courage to do so. Let's receive that into our spirit. Let's pray. Father, thank you for sending your own dear son. We know that it cost you everything when you sent your son, because you had to smite him. You struck him as the redemption price he had to pay on our behalf. And today, Lord Jesus, as we look at the word sacrifice, we want to know you better. What sacrifice really means. It will not just be a word, but we know, Lord, your face was marred more than any man. You lost your dignity. You lost everything on the cross for us because, Lord, you loved us. And as Paul concluded, the Son of God loved me and gave himself for me. And henceforth, Father, we vow that we'll never again say that you don't understand our suffering. You don't understand how hurt we are, how broken we are, how disadvantaged we are, because our Lord Jesus experienced all of them firsthand. We now receive that same courage and that sense of value, even when we have to suffer. That we'll suffer for Christ's sake, not because we have no courage, but now we have the courage. Jesus yourself suffered for us, leaving us an example. So we want to receive that courage from you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for going all the way for me. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.